What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to the Tampa Bay Buccaneers franchise here for episode 29 as season 4 continues. I do hope, and I say that very seriously, that we can get through a pretty good portion of the remaining schedule this episode. We've obviously watched a lot of our games in the first half. We had a lot of depth trade increases that I felt were pretty important. We secured quite a few of them. And for this series going forward, especially in next year, I do want to kind of get some rules put in place so I can prevent this from happening again. But here in this episode, I want to work through week 10. I do want to watch the game against the Browns. And then I think we'll sim up until week 14, or maybe through week 14 into week 15, depending on how things kind of work out. Tampa Bay is obviously undefeated with the best scoring offense and the best scoring defense in the league right now. It's been a really, really good start for this team. Obviously, we play Cleveland this game. The Bills are 7-1. We beat the Cowboys last episode. Bears are 6-2. Tennessee 6-2. A lot of teams here, you know, we still have half a season to go, but a lot of these teams are fighting for playoff spots for the first time in a long, long time. And there's a lot of season left to go. Unfortunately for teams like the Patriots, they're not seeing much success. Dolphins are 3-5, and here at the bottom of the board, Green Bay is 0-8. They could have the number one pick. Do they go quarterback? Maybe. I have no idea. I forgot to include this at the end of last episode. I was editing a little too quickly, but we know that Gant has superstar dev, our first round selection. His ability is secure tackler, which was pretty expected. Next ability obviously unlocked at 90 overall, which shouldn't take too long. Upgrades right now about 4,000 to 5,000 a pop. He is a focus player, so we should see hopefully 85 by the end of the year. That would be great. Gant so far, 24 tackles, 8 TFLs, and 4 sacks as a rookie. Overall, that's pretty solid production. I'm finally reminding myself to do this time. Obviously, we had to move Vea to get Gant in the first round. And Vea on the season, 25 tackles, 6 TFLs, and 1.5 sacks. So still not seeing enough pass rush, which is why we got rid of Vea in the first place, and Gant's obviously filled that role pretty well. Sean Murphy Bunting's first game as an X-Factor corner was pretty impressive, an 82 or 83-yard pick 6 in that game. Didn't get much use out of the X-Factor ability, but we are going to hopefully get him to a 90 to get that new one unlocked. On his way to his third Pro Bowl. 6 interceptions, which leads the NFL, also leads in pass deflections. Made the Pro Bowl as a rookie, made the Pro Bowl last year, and should obviously be a lock for it this season. Good thing we've got Murphy Bunting locked up until he's like 30 or 31. I can't wait to see where he's going to be at the end of his career. Hopefully a lifetime buck, but you never know what's going to happen. Good speed, good man coverage. I think we're going to mix it up here and go zone. Why not? He actually lost a morale bump there, but gets +2 zone, 1 tackle, 2 awareness, and 1 play rec. Can't begin negotiations with Mike Edwards yet. I think it's a little later in the year, maybe week 11 or week 12. But obviously, 75 overall star dev at 26 years old. I think we can afford an extension of a few more years. He's a playmaker. I mean, we're not seeing the interceptions that we saw last year, but we are seeing some pretty crucial pass breakups, which has been really important, and that's what's kept this defense, I think, this good. 76 overall now, a little zone tackle and +2 awareness for him as well. Moving Scott Miller from receiver to more of a third down flex back hasn't really worked out the way I thought it would, and it's more so due to the fact that I can't do formation subs in a custom playbook, which is really frustrating because you can do it in NCAA 14, but you can't do it in Madden. And it's really hurting what I wanted to have Miller do this year, which was catch the ball more in our 5-wide and 4-wide sets on third down. I mean, I could do that if I made him the starting third down back, but that would take snaps away from Hunter. And I don't really want Miller out there carrying the ball with his low carry rating. So That's not going to help, although that plus one speed might release catching traffic. Wow, I might move him back to receiver. 95 speed, 93 Excel. That's not too bad. I forgot, who did we trade to the Browns to get Mac Wilson? That was year one or year two. But Wilson's deal's up at the end of this year. He's been really good injury insurance for Van Der Esch and White. And only 3 tackling for Wilson. No receptions yet on the year for rookie Daryl Gerard, which is understandable considering the fact that this receiving core has been really healthy. Obviously, auto subs aren't working the way that they're supposed to, so still waiting for Gerard to see the field outside of special teams. We will go deep threat here, keep him a scheme fit up to a 68, and we get plus 3 for deep route running and 1 for catching. I don't know if that was the right decision. Maybe should have gone slot or physical that time. When did Ricky Seals-Jones get hurt? This had to have happened during the Cowboys game. I must have skipped through week 9 too quickly. I don't remember this, but a quad tear, he's out 5 weeks. For the Browns, they are also without a starting tight end, and Njoku's out along with Kirksey. So we'll see how that impacts this game. Odell Beckham Jr. versus Sean Murphy Bunting should be a really fun matchup. Myles Garrett is likely going to be an issue for Archer Young on that left side of the offensive line. Denzel Ward, a good matchup for Chris Godwin and Mike Evans. We've got some great matchups this game. Cleveland's one of those teams that you never know. They could make the postseason. They could have a really deep run. Greedy Williams, only an 83 at 24. Hasn't really developed that much. And then, oh, right, it was Justin Evans. Right. Evans is who we traded for Wilson. 2 interceptions in 2019, 2020. We traded him, I think, before the bye. And he had 1 pick last year. Nothing really impressive this year. Baker Mayfield right now an 89 overall with the plus 2 morale bump. He's a 91. Great accuracies across the board. Very good under pressure. Good break sack rating. Mobile as well. Mayfield is a pretty good quarterback with good traits. And obviously the Browns paid a lot to keep him around. I think the bonus was north of $100 million, which is not a good sign for us next year. And here we go for the biggest game on the schedule so far. This could be a potential Super Bowl matchup. Buccaneers-Browns. This should be a fun one. Baker Mayfield, 19 touchdowns, 3 interceptions on the year. And the Browns start with a run here to Nick Chubb, who's met by Yannick Ngakoue. Could have used a lot more of those TFLs in the last matchup we played. This is the part of the year where you're really watching the scores at the bottom of the screen as the Baltimore Ravens beat Pittsburgh. Here's a throw to Beckham that's broken up by Murphy Bunting. That ball came out a little quick there, and Ngakoue got around prior the rookie pretty quick. Offensive line across the board for the Browns, not too shabby, obviously. The skill players are pretty good. Murphy Bunting only needs one more pass breakup to turn on his ability. 3rd and 12. Cleveland to a screen. Chubb in space. Chubb to the 30. Can't get it. And Ngakoue saves a first down and maybe a lot more. We're just so late to react to screens up front. I think we brought a blitz there too, which didn't really help. But Cleveland does not get a first. Buccaneers offense on the field from the 24. 2 tight end set. Welcome back, Ricky Seals-Jones. 1st and 10, play fake. David Cole, great protection. Cole throwing downfield. This one hauled in. Chris Godwin for 31. Had to double team Garrett on that left side as Godwin crosses 500 receiving. Only 3 superstars for the Cleveland defense. And here's a run. Hunter down the middle into Schobert. And he gets to the 37. Looks like Garrett does move on this defensive front. So I'm not going to switch Young and Feliciano. 1st and 10, David Cole. Look at Feliciano shut down. Garrett Cole throws here to Mike Evans. Inside the 10. And the Buccaneers threatening to score early. David Cole in the zone for the first time as the Buccaneers have it at the 7. Here is Cole setting up a screen. What? That might have been the first screen that actually got something on the year. Second and goal. Cole throwing to the end zone and touchdown, Rashard Higgins. Excellent start for the Buccaneers offense. I'm pretty sure that was Greedy in coverage. It was. Greedy Williams not having a great start to this game. Cleveland goes three and out the first drive and now looking to maybe run the football. Baker Mayfield play fake here. Gant incoming in Mayfield. Just barely gets it off in time. Nearly a sack there. One of Mayfield's superstar abilities is the one that allows him to throw away while being hit. So we'll have to keep that under control, hopefully. And Chubb gets the nice run to the 32. Defense looking for another three and out as the Browns come out in the eye. And it's Mayfield under center, throwing a screen to Landry. And that is broken up by Horton. And no gain on the play. Another three and out for Cleveland. Buccaneers start from the 38-yard line after a bad punt. And here we are with a chance to make it a two-score lead pretty early as we go to the run. And that does not go anywhere. Hunter's getting close to 500 rushing. I know that. That should be a goal we can reach this game as we go play fake on second down. Good protection again. Cole throws. Evans catch first down. Cole starting 5 of 6, 80 yards. Obviously the touchdown, and this zone defense for the Browns has not done them any favors. Just short of midfield here. Hunter gets the football, runs through the defense. If he goes to the sideline, he might have been gone. Hunter gets 11, now at 500 yards rushing on the year. As long as Hunter stays healthy, I think 1,000 is definitely within reach. Would have been nice to get a few more in this run as he, for some reason, looked to initiate contact instead of avoiding it. I wonder if ball carrier vision would have had him, or higher ball carrier vision would have had him go to the sideline. Oh, that's right. The Browns did draft Amari Kincaid. So that's our first look at him as we go back to the run. Hunter inside the 30. We are running through, around, and over this Cleveland defense right now. Eduardo Casas checks in as the Buccaneers go to the eye. We run the ball this time with Howard. He gets up to the 22-yard line. Needing 5 yards here. Cole looking outside to Godwin, first down. Backed up 5 yards thanks to a false start as the Buccaneers come out in a too tight end look again. Running right side, Hunter brought down by Garrett, gain of one. Mike Evans lined up opposite of Denzel Ward, so they are following him around as Cole throws on the fake into the end zone is Chris Godwin. Corner blitz inside the 30, not the best idea. Chris Godwin on the board, and the Buccaneers with a really, really commanding start to this game. I mean, it's been all Bucs so far, both sides of the football, and Cleveland's got to bounce back here. Browns only have 13 yards through two drives. And why are we playing so far off Odell Beckham here? Baker Mayfield throwing that way. It's Beckham to the 31, and he's shaking up on the play. Tackled by Sean Murphy Bunting. So they've got a pretty big injury and a pretty bad start to overcome. They go to the run. Chubb shut down. Third down, 6 yards to go to avoid another three and out. Here is Mayfield. In comes the pressure, and in comes Ngakoue. Running through Pryor, the rookie, now 10 sacks on the year. This defense is too good. So the defense forcing three and outs. Can the offense get their third touchdown of the game as we start from the 45-yard line? Really good starting field position here to begin the game. O.J. Howard for 14 yards. And here we are inside the 30. David Cole looking for touchdown number 3 as he gets Marsh down to the 5. First and goal, Armon Hunter rushing touchdown. And that will make it a 21-0 lead here for the Bucs. If I knew that this was going to be the outcome of this game, I would have tried to watch the game against Seattle instead, but we're stuck in this one for now. Browns are trying to do something here. Nick Chubb getting a lot of work as he keeps this ball moving, and then a penalty on Chubb. A holding call on a running back? We don't see that very often. Chubb gets 6, 2nd and 14, and Gakwe, 2nd sack of the game. And on 3rd and 17, intercepted Vernon Hargreaves. Buccaneers get going from the 39. And here's Hunter for 24 through the air. And then Mike Evans, 15-yard touchdown. 28-0 with the extra point. Cleveland's in trouble. This is not a good look for them at all. Well, this formation's a little scary. Buccaneers crowd the line. Here's a pitch outside the Chubb, and there's a nice tackle by Sean Murphy Bunting. 3rd and 11. Mayfield throwing quickly here to Landry. Nearly picked off. He should have been for the second time. Instead, another 3 and out. That's one of their better play calls on 3rd down, but our defense was ready for it. Should have been a easy pick for Horton, but at least knocking the ball away, that works. Buccaneers lead 28-0, and I don't know how much this starting offense will see the field in the second half at this rate, as Evans actually dropped the pass there. That's rare. I formation from the 21. Cole to throw again. Good protection outside. Ball intercepted. Denzel Ward flagged down on the play. That is likely holding, and indeed it will be on Lane Haynes. So we are not going to... Wait, the game just froze. Seriously? Really? Okay, the game loaded back up with no issues, but it looks like we still have the ball. The interception, or at least the play where the interception occurred, did not get recorded, even though it showed possession change. But the Buccaneers have it here at the 21. Hunter with a nice run to the 28-yard line. I think that would have been Cole's 3rd interception of the year, so we'll put an asterisk next to that on the stat sheet at the end of the season. 3rd down and 3. We go to a screen. Okay, we do have a screen on 3rd down. They were playing really off coverage there. Evans at 750 receiving. Nice. We just keep doing what the Browns can't, and that's convert 3rd downs. As Cole throws on 1st down, Mike Evans again gets away from Denzel Ward and gets to the 41. Soft zone coverage strikes again. It looks like cover 4. It might be cover 6, which explains why the sidelines are so open. Cole on 1st down has pressure in his face, but off in time, the Godwin, who stays in bounds and gets inside the 10. I can't explain it. I can't. These receivers are making too many plays. 9 yards away from another potential David Cole touchdown as the Buccaneers go play fake on 1st and goal. Cole looking, pressure incoming, it's Garrett, and down goes Cole at the 25. No. This isn't good. This is not good. Gotta throw the ball away there, Cole, as he's heading off to the locker room, and it will be Daniel Jones entering the game at quarterback here. Luckily, we have a 28-point lead. So, even if Jones somehow stinks it up, which I don't think he will, we'll be okay. Jones' 1st completion goes to Evans. I'll take that. 3rd and goal from the 22. Jones looking. Good protection and a complete miss. Yeah, we're in for a lot of that this game. Jones was really wishy-washy in the preseason with his accuracy, and now we are going to have to settle for 3 points, which I don't mind, but it's not what I wanted. Okay, so this game is just not going to go well from this point on. Got it. The Browns are really trying to work this run game, and it has not been great so far. Chubb does get a few yards here, but brought down by Mike Edwards, and now he's shaken up. Odell Beckham is back in the ballgame, by the way. Bottom of the screen against Murphy Bunting as Mayfield throws on 3rd down, complete. And that does move the chains. 2-minute warning just hit. Here's another third down for Cleveland. Mayfield looking under pressure. Sack again for Ngakoue. Timeout Buccaneers. Not too sure how much I want to see Daniel Jones throw the ball this 2-minute drill, but from the 14-yard line, he'll throw to a wide-open receiver and completely miss. And that just goes to show you, you can have the same play call, the same receivers, the same open looks, and the quarterback just has to make the throw. David Cole does that. Buccaneers need 6 yards on this third down. Jones from the 18-yard line will throw underneath. Howard is not going to get there. Timeout, Cleveland. Our 2-minute drill offense still needs some work. We're running stick way too much. I need to fix that. First and 10, Baker Mayfield sacked again in Ngakoue 4. Where was this against Carolina? And this offensive line is better. Like, Pryor's a near 80 overall rookie. Where was this last game? Should just see them try to run out the rest of the clock here as they will hand off. And there's Edwards to the 26. Why are we calling a timeout? What's the point? I would love to know why we called two timeouts back-to-back to leave us with no time on a punt return. They got fair caught. What was the point? Seriously, 28-0. What just happened? I haven't seen this glitch in a while. So the game's going to pick up in the third quarter where Marsh fair caught the ball to in the second quarter, which is weird. It did have a starting from our 27, so it's almost like it was a kick return. So not too bad. Daniel Jones still in the game at quarterback. I'm not checking the injury report as he misses again. I got to draft the quarterback I can develop. Third and 7, Jones looking left sideline, touch pass to Chris Godwin, is hauled in. That was kind of lucky, 26-yard pickup, Godwin 114, not bad. Only a 2-yard pickup on first down, now a toss right, Feliciano, look at the speed, and Hunter does it again. If he stays wide, that's a touchdown. Back in range for points here from the 27, and another run for Hunter right down the middle and inside the 15. 74 yards now, 6.7 a carry. Miller the back on first down as Chris Godwin moves in motion. Play fake, Jones, good protection as he will throw to the end zone and is caught by Jameson Marsh. 5 touchdowns on the year, a 34-0 lead for the Buccaneers. Again, zone coverage. It's not helping you, Cleveland. If Daniel Jones is tearing you apart, you've got problems. The Browns entering this game were 7-1. I'm not going to lie, I don't know why. 35-0 lead and a penalty on Horton, of all people. Browns keeping this ball moving, 3rd and 6. No, they won't. They will punt here, and we start from the 20. So the Buccaneers hopefully just keeping this on the ground, although Godwin will get a few grabs here and there. Armon Hunter, 5-yard reception, and then Vernon with a penalty. Hunter gets 4 more. Then an incompletion, then another 4-yard run for Hunter. Just chewing up clock. Can't complain. We're doing a really good job moving the ball, although we are going to stall here, punt the ball down to the 6. And here come the Browns. Start of the 4th quarter. 2nd down, intercepted, Devin White! Pick 6 again! This kid's good. 41-0. 41-0 over the 7-1 Browns. 42-0. Can't automatically count these field goals and extra points anymore. We missed quite a few of these. And then Ngakoue, another sack. What is that? 5? 6. That's got to be a record. What a game for Ngakoue. Where was this 2 weeks ago, though? Really? We might send the rest of this game. 42-0. Buccaneers should just be able to grind out the rest of this ball game. Hunter does not get the first, though. Needed 2, only got 1. Baker Mayfield trying to get something going here for the Browns. 7 sacks for Ngakoue. Excuse me, sir. You had your chance at X Factor Dev. You missed it. We're not doing this again. Buccaneers take over from the 37. We end up losing two, getting two back, and then only getting three. So maybe running the ball a bit too much here. A lot of failed third downs, and luckily we have a 42-0 lead. But the Browns... Okay, there's Odell Beckham finally getting something inside the red zone. And that's incomplete. Edwards for five. And then a penalty on Mike Edwards. So first and goal from the six. Incomplete. Second and goal. They get down to the two. And then they lose three on the ground. So the Browns, why would you take 3 points there? You're down 42-0. At least, I mean, they at least got something. Inside the final 2 minutes, clock should be running all the way down here. And we fail to convert again. So the Browns, 37-yard line, minute on the clock, third and 10. Paulson gets there this time. What a game. What a game. Hunter runs out the final seconds. And there is your Week 10 victory statement for the postseason. Give us the best team in the AFC. We will handle them the way that we need to. This team is unfair. Unfair. Browns just get over 100 yards passing. Two turnovers, 63 yards rushing. Meanwhile, we dominated. See you in the playoffs, Baker Mayfield. David Cole, 15 of 19, 255 and 3 scores. Not a bad game for a guy that only played a quarter and a half. Baker Mayfield, 2 interceptions, no scores. Daniel Jones, 10 for 16, 1 score, throwing pretty decently. It wasn't great, wasn't too bad. Armand Hunter, 23 carries, 4.4 carry to put him over 100 on the game, plus a score. Nick Chubb did not return. Edwards kept a 2.8 a carry. Pretty great game. Chris Godwin, 128, 1 touchdown. Mike Evans, 95 and 1 score. So our top two receivers playing well. Meanwhile, the Browns receivers didn't do much. Jameson Marsh, 53 and 1 score. Beckham, 43. He was pretty much shut down the entire game. 14 tackles, 3 for a loss, and 7 sacks for Ngakoue this game. I don't even know how to explain it. Hargreaves and Whitehead interceptions this game. Armstead, 3 tackles and 1 for a loss. And I brought this up last episode, but man, the rush we're getting off the edge with Paulson and Ngakoue since they become superstars, or at least since they've unlocked those 90 overall abilities, it is really hurting our interior defensive linemen, or at least their sack production. I mean, Armstead last year had, what, 6 or 7 sacks on the year. This year, I think he's only got 2 or 3. And it's because Ngakoue and Paulson are shooting around these teams with really bad tackles. And they're not giving these inside guys a chance at all. Look at me complaining about defensive linemen not getting sacks. That is a first world problem. Incredible. We win the game the way we did, and I'm complaining about defensive linemen getting sacks. Third downs could have been better. You know, we did run the ball a lot in the second half. Fell a few yards short each time, but overall, great game for the Bucs. So week 10 was a big one for the Buccaneers, and David Cole is not hurt. That, oh man, that's such a sigh of relief. It was only a game time injury. He'll be back. That's great news. Back in prime time in week 11 to take on the Steelers. We will not watch this game. And of course, Ngakoue, your NFC Defensive Player of the Week. Haskins had a good game. Winston played okay in a loss to the Bengals. Landry, 4 sacks and 7 tackles for Tennessee. 52 tackles, 13 TFLs, and now 16 sacks on the year for Ngakoue, which now leaves the team. Paulson at 14.5. So you're looking at two guys that are very good at getting to the quarterback. And Ngakoue really is starting to live up to that $20 million a year contract we gave him back in the first offseason. Would have been nice to see these numbers 2 years ago. Last year wasn't too bad, but at least he's getting some production this year. Ngakoue not just with a new franchise record, but also ties the NFL record for sacks in a game with 7. That's a pretty strong performance. Ngakoue joining a lot of really good players. That's pretty cool to see. 88 speed, 79 zone, 84 man, good pursuit, good hit power. Tackling could use a little work along with block shedding. I think we'll go run support for the first time in a long time with Hemingway, who goes up to an 83, somehow lost his morale boost, which is weird, but plus 2 for play rec and tackling. Gant is such a special player, and a little foreshadowing for the offseason, he could be the only player returning from this defensive line unit, or at least the starters. So we got to make sure that he's very good with his run defense. We get plus 2 block shed and 1 tackle, which is pretty good. Up to an 82 overall. And yeah, he's pretty good. Still working on getting Horton's man coverage into the 80s. It's been a really slow burn because we've been getting so many plus 1 man coverages. And there we go again. It's making it hard. It's making it really hard. 79, 80 with the plus 1 morale bump. But this is frustrating. Going with the power upgrade for Lane Haynes this time as he moves up to an 81 with the plus 1 morale boost. Plus 2 awareness, 1 for run block, and 1 for pass block and run block power. David Cole's sack numbers aren't as improved as I would like, but Kamani Proctor seems to be doing a pretty good job at center, and we will try to help pass blocking, and we don't get much there. Evan Moore, 74 overall. He did miss a pretty easy kick from what I could tell. So we are going to try to boost accuracy a little bit here. Moore goes up to a 76 and 3 upgrades. He gets accuracy and power and 2 awareness. I've never seen that. We've got some pretty tough decisions to make next year when it comes to the offensive line. And we could see some of these backups become starters. Terrell Nance will get a pass block upgrade here. He does get 1 pass block and then 1 for finesse power and also 1 awareness. That's not too bad there either. This game a lot closer than week 10, but the Buccaneers get it done again. 27-24 win over the Pittsburgh Steelers. Buccaneers offense played pretty well. Our run defense has been spectacular for most of this year. We had 2 takeaways and we were only 2 of 3 in the red zone. And time of possession was in favor of the Steelers. That's kind of weird. David Cole throws for 274, 1 touchdown, sacked 1 time. Sam Darnold, 2 touchdowns, 2 interceptions, wasn't sacked at all, threw for 281. So a good job by our secondary. Armon Hunter, 21 for 95, 4.5 a carry. Connor, 63, 1 score. And Jordan Howard, 2 scores off of 3 carries and 10 yards. Mike Evans does it again. 7 for 107, not bad. Armon Hunter, 59 yards receiving, plus the running performance. Marsh had 25 and a score. Outside of Evans, not too much. 12 tackles for Devin White, 1 for a loss, and his 4th interception of the year. Devin White's been doing this all year, and it's getting kind of crazy. Was it a pick 6, though? It was not, unfortunately. Horton at 9 tackles, Edwards 7, Hemingway with 5, Van Der Esch 5, Murphy Bunting 4. Paulson no sack this game, and Noah Spence at the other interception? Really? Nelson 1 tackle, and Ngakoue only 1. Well, that's a really big fall off from that game against the Browns. Evan Moore with another miss. 2 of 3 on the game, longest kick 47 yards, and perfect on extra points, but that miss I'm assuming was from outside 50, and it was. So, maybe I need to work on power, although he got power and accuracy last time. Our player of the week streak continues. This time, it will be Devin White with the 12 tackle, 1 interception performance. Cam, 273, 3 scores, and a really good throwing day. 21 of 23, Mahomes, 4 scores. 10 games into the year, Buccaneers remain undefeated. Offense doing its job, defense also playing really well. But the Cowboys, I mean, we beat them and they're right back to winning. Bears are 8-2, 4 straight wins. 8-2 are the Bills. Panthers 7-3. Titans are 7-3. There's a lot of teams here fighting for playoff spots. So obviously, while our season's going really well, an injury could derail us and put us in a place where we could be in a lot of trouble, especially if the Panthers keep heating up. Miami so far the longest losing streak I've seen. Five straight losses, which is good news for us. And the Packers have actually won two straight games, while the Vikings have lost two straight. Another bad year for them. As the college season winds down, we should see a few more draft stories. Tight end Buc White has a little issue with maturity. It's always these really small, insignificant things that get these good players moved back, as we saw with Paulson a few years ago. And Kamari Miner, who was a top five player, and I'm pretty sure the top defensive end, he's no longer playing football. That's pretty serious right there. I don't think I ever scouted Miner because we wouldn't have had a chance to get him, but he was the number one left end. That is a pretty big blow to what's looking like a pretty weak defensive end class. And the top two guys, they are really more so outside linebackers. Buc White moves from number one to number three on the tight end big board. Now an early second round projection. And I might as well scout the 21-year-old with B+ catching, B- spec, and B- catching traffic. So a mid-first rounder, he's still going to go top 32, but we'll see what happens. Update here, the draft board, 11 weeks into the year, we are 45 players deep. And at the rate we're going, we are definitely picking 32nd. Kansas City on the bubble to make the postseason could keep us from having an early second round pick. But if there's someone worth taking, I could package the twos, maybe one of the threes, and move up to get someone that I think is worth taking. Could it be a running back? Could it be a receiver? Could it be another offensive lineman in another really good offensive line class? Jabari Lowell is by far my favorite player on the board right now. Mid-third round projection, early first round talent, a great pass blocker. And he's not someone that slipped back due to a draft story, he's just that good. Denard Cummins from Texas A&M, who is a third rounder with a first round grade, did slide back, so that's something to keep in mind. Quarterbacks, obviously, something on my mind again. Jimmy Walsh from Virginia Tech did have a draft story that moved him back, but the talent matches the projection, and that top three is really good. So he could be the backup next year, maybe. No upgrade for Ngakoue after the 7-sack performance, but he will get an upgrade here as he looks to move past the 90 overall threshold to a 91. I don't know when exactly regression kicks in for Ngakoue because it kicked in at 26-27 for Howard and Clement last year, so I guess it kicks in at different points for different positions. And at this point, I mean, 96 finesse, we don't need to work on that anymore. I am going to go power here. And I think I might do the same thing with Paulson in the near future, but the overall doesn't move. One awareness, one power, one strength, and one tackle. Ngakoue was already really good. That just made him better. Haven't seen much of Rashard Higgins the past 2 years. We brought him in 2020. He was our number three receiver. That role has now gone to Jameson Marsh. He's been great in that spot. And Higgins, up to a 78. Pretty good upgrade there for him. Upgrade here for the backup right guard, Randall Kirby, who we took in the second or third round last year. We are going to go pass protector. Maybe should have gone agile, but we got to get these pass block ratings up for these backups, and that's going to help quite a bit. Unfortunately, pass block finesse is really, really bad. Tampa Bay wins again. Unfortunately, we give up 35 points to Russell Wilson and the Seahawks. I'm pretty sure that's the highest point total we've given up this year. Overall, just another really good game for this offense. We are running at a consistency we have not seen yet in this series. And for whatever reason, time of possession, when it's like a one-score game, it's like 50-50, which doesn't make any sense. Simmons just really weird in this game. I think that'll wrap up NFC Player of the Week. David Cole, 5 touchdowns, 300 yards, a 71-yard bomb to someone. I'm pretty sure that was Mike Evans. Only sacked once this game. Wilson was sacked twice, 3 scores, 1 pick, and threw for 321. So not bad for the Seahawks. Hunter, 24 carries, 85 yards, 4 broken tackles, and 3 yards after contact. The only runner to have any yards after contact. Wilson had 2 scores rushing, 35 yards. Homer fumbled. I'm going to guess that's where the other turnover came from. And Scott Miller had a touchdown this game. That's pretty good. I've said it once, and I'll say it again. When David Cole has a great game, you can bet that Mike Evans is putting up big numbers. 7 for 112, 3 scores. Marsh, 65 and 2. OJ Howard, 42. Hunter had 38. Miller, 23. Godwin, what happened? 1 for 10. Howard also 1 for 10. And then for the Seahawks, DK Metcalf, 84 yards, 1 score. I do want to check his numbers after this game. Devin White, 8 tackles on the game, along with Van Der Esch and Hemingway, 7 tackles, 1 interception. Our secondary is playing great this year. Damian Gant, 5 tackles, 3 for a loss. That's pretty impressive, too. Run defense looked pretty good this game. A lot of TFLs, despite Wilson running pretty consistently. And sacks on the game, we had 2. And Gakwe with another one. And Hargreaves and Paulson split the second. Taking on the Saints here in week 13, but would you look at that? David Cole, of course, is your player of the week. Ambrose, 10 tackles, 1 pick for the Vikings. Chip Sherry having a really good season. Second-year quarterback for Jacksonville, and Clowney with 2 sacks. So DK Metcalf at 24 years old, superstar, of course, 6'3", 228 with blazing speed, and unfortunately, he has not really improved in the route running department, only 71 deep. I mean, the catching is all great. I guess they've been going really heavy into physical for him, but deep route running should be his game. And I think that might have something to do with his lack of production outside of 2020. I mean, this year, 45 yards a game, and they did give him a new deal. So he's on a 5-year extension at 10 mil a year. It's not bad. We still have five games left on the year. Mike Evans just crossed 1,000 yards. 92 yards per game, 10 touchdowns. It's just been an incredible year for him. And there's no way he's not crossing at least 1,400. Chris Godwin at 683 and 3 scores. He's got a chance, but I need him to pick up the pace. We're paying him a lot of money. He's got to get 1,000 yards this year. Upgrade here for George Paulson, 94 finesse, 76 block shed, 74 power, great strength, great speed. I think we're going to go finesse for the final time for Paulson. We do get +1 finesse, +1 zone, a little acceleration. Devin White with the big extension this year and obviously making the big plays on defense. Great speed, very good in coverage, and at this point, the only thing I'm concerned about right now is not even a concern. I just think we need to work on run blocking. Block shed would be great. We do get +1 for that. +3 for man from run stopper? Excuse me? Why are these linebacker archetypes so weird? Mike Evans, Chris Godwin, and Jamison Marsh have been a perfect trio for David Cole, which has led to a lot of our pass production. Marsh's contract is up next year along with Cole's, and I would love to keep both of them around. I mean, just keeping this tandem together. Marsh has improved every year. He didn't play much as a rookie, unfortunately. He did get the nod to be the slot receiver last year, and obviously that is the case again this season. And as much as I want to go physical to maybe get a little more catch in traffic, I do want to keep him a scheme fit. We do get deep route running, jumping, medium, release, and spec catch. Not bad. Nelson with 78 speed, 76 block shed, 81 power. I'm not super impressed with this class at outside linebacker. Nelson's contract is up at the end of the year. He's likely going to stay. +2 for power. And that will be a sweep of the NFC South. What a game. 150 rushing for us, only 28 for the Saints. Another turnover forced, and then 5 of 5 in the red zone. And time of possession, finally not a split 50-50. We pretty much dominated this game. David Cole and Dustin Baldwin both sacked 4 times this game, which is a little concerning, but the Saints do have a good front 7, so I did expect a few. Cole, 238, 2 scores, throwing 19 of 25, so 75% again. No Alvin Kamara for the Saints this week. Armon Hunter, 19 carries, 83 yards, and 4.4 a carry. This ground game with him at the helm has been really impressive, to say the least. It's been great. Jamison Marsh, 97 yards, 2 scores. Noah Brown, 70 and 2 scores as well. Safarian Jenkins, 52. Howard, 44. Godwin, 41. Evans, a bit of a fall off this week, but you can't do it every week. 38 yards. I do like shutting down Michael Thomas in both matchups, though. George Paulson and Damian Gant get it done. Paulson, 2 sacks. Gant, 1.5. Not bad from the front 7 in all this game. Ngakoue, 4 tackles, 2 for a loss. Murphy Bunting, 3 tackles. Horton had a pick this game. Pretty cool. This is not the time for this. It's not. Partial MCL tear for Ngakoue. He will miss 7 weeks, so that's obviously the rest of the regular season. He's going to miss our first playoff game. He might be back for the NFC Championship. I don't know. If he gets a chance to return early, I might have to do it. But 17 sacks, that's where his season will end, unfortunately. Looks like the Fighting Irish had all the good DBs this year. Jason Keaton's the top strong safety. Melo Lewis just set the school record for interceptions this year. Unfortunately, I don't think Lewis is going to be a target of ours. He is the top player on the board right now since Miner left. Although I think Lewis was number one regardless. B plus man, B awareness, B press. Might as well scout him because I'm out of stuff to scout. He is 23, but he's more than likely going to be the number one player off the board, I would bet. Really good top three combine. Hopefully it should be good for him. Anthony Feliciano's contract is up next year. He obviously will be very expensive. Great pass blocker, 95 strength. I mean, what can't he do? And just thinking ahead, we have 4 of our 5 offensive linemen next year looking for new contracts. Feliciano, Marpet, Haynes, Archer Young. Feliciano gets plus 2 strength there. That's not too shabby. Obviously, he will be the first player, if not the only lineman we give a new contract to. He's really good. Like, how can you not give him the money? He's the number 6 ranked tackle in the league. Chris Godwin's a great route runner. He's got great hands. I don't know why we're not seeing more production from him when we sim. It's a bit weird, but deep threat we go again. 5 upgrades, acceleration, awareness, catching traffic, deep route running, and elusiveness. That should help a lot here. Second upgrade of the episode for Damian Gant, who is now working with 73 morale, which is giving him a little more power, a little more block shed. And we are going run stopper again. Keep working towards the scheme fit. We get plus 2 awareness, 1 block shed, hit power, strength, and tackle. That's all really, really good. That's fantastic. Archer Young's come a long way in 2 years, and we will continue to work on his pass protection ability here up to a 79. Awareness, plus 2 for pass block and strength again. We are getting strength thrown left and right this episode. This is kind of cool. Armon Hunter is 134 yards away from the first 1,000-yard rushing season in this series. And obviously there are a lot of things that contribute to this. The offensive line is fantastic. Hunter is running pretty well, is making smart decisions. But the biggest thing here is durability. He's been healthy since Howard went down the first series of the year. And we will go elusive here to kind of mix things up a little bit. He will get plus 4 for elusiveness. So hopefully seeing a little more yak from Armon Hunter this year. I didn't check the standings last week, so I don't know if we just clinched or if we clinched last week, but regardless, Tampa Bay is heading back to the postseason, more than likely with a first round bye. Browns just lost. Cowboys lost a game, but they just won again. Bears lost. Giants have won 2 straight, so they're likely going to make it in, although you never know. Tennessee's 8-4. Interesting. Arizona's 8-4. Colts are 8-4. Ravens 7-5 might be good enough for the AFC. Not for the NFC, though. Falcons, 3 wins in a row. Lions, 3 in a row. The Chiefs have lost 2 straight. Thank you very much. Keep that going. So the plan was to end the episode here, but I think we're going to sim one more game, take us to week 15. We'll start off against Chicago, then play the Rams, and then watch the Ravens game and then end the episode there. And then we'll be in the postseason. Should be a fun two, hopefully three games this time. 49-28 victory makes us 13-0 on the season. Five takeaways on Andy Dalton and the Bengals. Joe Burrow is not here to save you yet, Cincy. He's not here yet. How are we 3 of 6 in the red zone with no turnovers? David Cole throws for 304 yards, 3 touchdowns. Andy Dalton, 368, 3 scores, but 4 interceptions. Cole was sacked once. And Dalton, 57% on the game. So this isn't like the last time this happened where Howard had a bunch of carries and Hunter didn't. They had the same number of carries, but the production was completely just polar opposites of one another. Miller had another score, but 10 for 15? We can have this slow down here this late in the year. Mike Evans back with another 100-yard game. Jameson Marsh. He low-key might get to 1,000. Godwin, 25 yards. He's not trying hard enough. I don't know how to fix this. A lot of interceptions this game. Murphy Bunting had 1 plus 9 tackles. Horton had 2 plus 8. And Devin White, 1 more plus 6 tackles and 2 for a loss. This defense just continues to make plays. No Ngakoue this game. Where is Paulson? Wow, 1 tackle. I guess I'm having a hard time understanding how we went 3 for 6 in the red zone. Evan Moore didn't have a field goal attempt, so we didn't miss anything. So I'm guessing we either went for it on 4th down 3 times and failed, or something's not right with the stats. Week 15's here. The Heisman has been awarded, and it goes to Texas A&M running back Quincy Lloyd. We could have a shot at 2 Heisman winners from Texas A&M in this series. That would be great. But Matthew Clinton, who is the receiving back who I liked a little bit more, also had a positive draft story. His stock goes up. David Cole was the Heisman winner for season 1. Dustin Baldwin, the quarterback for the Saints, was the Heisman winner for last year. I can't remember year 2. I think it was one of those corners. But here we are with a running back this time, Quincy Lloyd, who has an early first round projection as he's currently the 9th ranked player on the board, but a late first round talent grade, even with the draft story. Cole came in with superstar dev, Baldwin came in with superstar dev, so maybe we'll see superstar dev again, but Matthew Clinton could be the better value. Late first round projection, early first round grade, but at the same time, you have to remember that running backs tend to not get picked in the first round. They tend to go either late first or early second, which is where we're picking at 32, more than likely. Let's not jinx our season. But if I'm being honest, is running back even something that needs to be addressed? I would like to. Clinton's definitely my favorite back of the 3 or 4 I've scouted so far, but if we could package like that first and the Chiefs second round pick to move up a little bit, that would be really cool. So that, guys, will do it for this episode. Actually, let's check the weekly award that goes to Horton with the 2 interception game. But week 15 right around the corner, and so is the postseason. Bears, I believe, are in line to win the North, and we'll see if Ricky Seals-Jones returning provides much of an impact for an already good offense. But the Bears are a team I would expect to meet in the postseason again. Obviously, they ended our run in the NFC Championship game. It was a horrible game for David Cole and our run defense. And obviously, that's been pretty good this year. So thank you all for tuning in. Hope you enjoyed. Catch you guys next time. Have a nice day.